Hello. And my guest today was born in 1917 in East Ham, world to the east of the City of London, the cockney daughter of Bert and Annie Welsh, Bert being a docker and Annie a dressmaker as well as a hard-working wife and mother. Their daughter has undoubtedly become a national treasure, whose honours include having a pair of her shorts on display at the Imperial War Museum. She's Dame Vera Lynn. Hello, Vera.
Hello,
now, you were born in the middle of the First World War. Do you remember talk of war and fighting in your childhood, even though it was
Well, not really. I mean, 1917 was over in 1918, because I was only a year old when it finished, so I don't remember anything at all.
What is your first memory?
Well, I think it is probably when, because I had an uncle who was who used to do the clubs, semi-pro, as you would call. They apparently found out that I could sing at a very early age. And I can still remember quite clearly the flat that we lived in at that time. And my uncle used to come round and get me up out of bed when I was 2 and a half or something just to sing to them. And the early years, I suppose, my father belonged to Working Men's Club, and we spent a lot of our young days in the club at the concerts.
Mm-hmm. How many were you in the family? You sisters and brothers?
No, just one brother, Roger. Mm-hmm. He joined up and he was in the Air Force during the war.
Older than you or younger?
He's 3 years older. And
you must have been rather a petted little girl with a big brother and a very
well,
special...
Well, no, I remember one of my early memories of he and I having a good old fight up in the kitchen. And I punched him on the nose and made his nose bleed. And that upset me very much. And I don't think we ever had a real fisticuff fight after that. But you know what brothers are. They go off with their mates. And it really wasn't until we got more or less in our young teens that we really got sort of to go out together to dances and things.
Was it a close family? Were your parents very involved with all you did?
Yes, I mean the whole family. I had we lived with a grandma, and another grandma was round the corner. My aunts and uncles lived round there too. So
very
of course,
East End in many ways.
Yes, yes. We always seemed to have a lot of get-togethers and parties. And an aunt of mine, she used to play the piano because in her young days she was on the musicals in an act with another girl. And, of course, she was the pianist and well, you know, I suppose that's why I sort of grew up singing a lot.
Part of a family tradition. What sort of songs did you sing?
Who's Sorry Now and My Mother's Eyes. I remember singing that when I was 9. It was never the... what I call the bright and breezy songs. They were always
well,
a sentiment.
There was a long time that went between first singing My Mother's Eyes when you were 9 to when you recorded it.
Yes, so, I was asked to do something which I'd wanted to do for many years, and that was to go to Nashville, or not necessarily to go to Nashville, but to make a country album, because I felt, you know, I had that kind of voice that I would enjoy singing the songs. And then when I was asked to go to Nashville, of course that was a great thrill for me, and I was asked to select a whole load of songs, and I thought of My Mother's Eyes. I thought, well, that really is in the style of country.
Well, let's hear it now.
Oh, lovely.
Guiding light that taught me wrong from right, I found in my mother's eyes. Back in childhood days, I can remember love. Showered on me, mother's eyes would gaze at me so tender. What was their meaning? wrong from right, I found in my mother's eyes. Those baby tales she told, that road all paved with gold, I found in my mother's eyes. Selfish love I found in my mother's eyes.
My Mother's Eyes, sung by Dame Vera Lynn, my guest today. A marvellous song in many ways. Very suitable today, of course.
Absolutely, for Mother's Day.
Yes, for this weekend, which is rather nice.
Yes.
You, like me, started out with a good sort of gorblimey accent, didn't you, both of us?
That's right. I was used to do some rather fourth-rate pantomime, I should say. I can't even say it's a third-rate. And when I was about 14, I was the fairy queen because I was tall and blonde. One of the artists once said to me, oh, you won't ever make the grade because you're too common.
Oh, that awful word they used to use.
Yes.
It was just an accent. Yes. It didn't mean to say you were.
Well, when I started broadcasting in about 1935, what I did was to get a teacher who... I didn't want to get all la-di-da. I didn't. I wanted to keep a basic accent, but I just wanted to smooth it off a bit, mm-hmm. you know. And I used to wander around the music publishers with a copy of Shakespeare under my arm.
Looking terribly intellectual.
Yes, intellectual, mm. but really not reading it very often. But, you know, I was looking back when you said, can you remember anything from your early days? So I got out an old scrapbook of mine that dates back to, actually, the first one in it is 1934, and it says, a star is rising in the east.
Oh, it's lovely.
Yes, and... East Ham's latest contribution to crooning, because, of course, in those days we were called crooners.
The pictures of you there, when you were this young performer, you're very glamorous. They're always looking over your shoulder with that particular 1930s
sort
of look.
That's right. And look at the size of the microphone. It's enormous,
huge.
Isn't it? Enormous.
Oh, and by the way, when did Lynn happen? After all, you were Vera Welsh.
Ah, yeah. Well, that came about when I was about 11. And by this time I was... doing a lot of concerts on the clubs and cabarets and things like that. And up to then, I'd been Vera Welsh. And it didn't look right to me. It didn't sound right. So we had a little family conference, and my grandmother came up. She says, well, I said, well, I do want a short name, something that, you know, wouldn't take up a lot of room on bill heads and things.
It could be written large.
It could be written large because there weren't many letters in it. So my grandma came up with the idea. She said, well, why not about my maiden name, which was Lynn? So we thought, well, that sounds good, Vera Lynn. You know, it's short and equal lettering. So that's how it came about when I was about 11.
The second record you've chosen is a man singer. Is this because you stopped listening to the girls? You've chosen John McCormick.
Oh, well, no, Sunshine of Your Smile. That was one of the songs that my dad used to sing when we used to have... My dad had a nice voice, and he used to sing that one, and Laugh and the World Laughs With You. My grandmother had a lovely voice. She didn't sing professionally, but she used to, when she was young, do charity concerts. And that takes me back to our little family gatherings when I was a child.
Well, let's take you back right now with John McCormick and The Sunshine of Your Smile.
But a whole so sweet a smile.
smile for me. Were you not mine, how dark the world would be. I know no lies above that could replace love's radiant sunshine in your dear, dear face. Give me your smile, the love light in your eyes. Life could not fall.
John McCormack with The Sunshine of Your Smile. And Vera, I wish we'd left your microphone open during that and the world could have heard you in duet with John McCormack. It's a lovely song.
Oh, yes, beautifully done. Sentimental.
Well, we heard all about your singing as a little girl, but did you go to school? You must have done, of course.
Oh, yes, I did. And I wasn't a very brilliant student, I'm afraid. I was always... all my high marks I got with anything that had to do with my hands. I liked sewing and painting, drawing, leather work, even gardening. We had a garden and we used to go out and do gardening. Anything, cookery, anything with my hands. But the brain, I think I did improve 1 year, I know, and we got a very nice teacher. And I think this means so much. If you get a teacher that understands you...
And
I know one of my books that I've got at home, you know, and I really went number one on 1 week, because in those days we used to keep a weekly account of the work you used to do, and then it was summarised at the end of the month or quarter, whatever, by the teacher, you know. Mm-hmm. Vera could work harder, or she showed probably, you know, the usual thing.
Everyone I've talked to had the same basic school reports. Could do better if she tried.
Yeah.
I think it tells us more about the teachers than about the pupils, that sort of comment, don't you?
And occasionally, if I was going to one of these competitions and I wanted to get off school early, I remember one teacher I had, well, here we go back again to a teacher, she flatly refused to let me go off that little bit earlier, so I remember running home like mad, you know, to get home to have a tidy up, a wash and a change into my dress and everything to get across to the cinema to get in time for the and I know on one occasion I arrived just as the preceding girl or boy, I can't remember what, was on. And then I arrived in the wings and they allowed me to go on. I think I got second in that.
That obviously school didn't approve. But what about the other children
didn't.
At school? What did they think of the fact that you were actually on a stage and singing?
Well, they didn't think very much of me, you see, because in those days, when you sang in class or with the school, everything was too high for me. I used to have everything transposed lower, and I could never get up there.
Nymphs and shepherds are not very high.
Yes, so of course when I'd get to a certain point in the range when I have to go up high, and I couldn't get up there. So, in fact, they thought so little of my singing that they only put me in the front row because I opened my mouth nice and wide. Not because they liked the sound of my voice.
Did you make many friends at school? Or was all your free time used in singing?
Well, yes, because weekends was the time that one went round to the clubs, you see. Mm-hmm. Saturdays and Sundays, doing either a little cabaret or a concert somewhere. So I really didn't have a lot of opportunity. I had certain girlfriends, but I didn't have the opportunity like, you know, my mother was very strict with me anyway. She wouldn't let me just go out in the street and play. And it was a great event if she let me go to the park. You know, she sort of, I suppose, sheltered me a little bit.
Did they, how shall I put it, encourage you, push you, or just stand back while you
No, made no, mum and dad always travelled with me. And, of course, dad being a club member, you know, we were affiliated no matter where we went. I had every encouragement. Until I was about 14, and then my mum said, well, no, you've got to have a job. You've got to have a real job. You can't rely on this singing because, you know, there's no future in it.
Mm. And, the classic parental response, isn't it?
That's right. And I know it took me 6 weeks to go to the Labour Exchange. It took me 6 weeks to find a job. And then when I did, it only lasted a day.
What was the job?
Well, mum thought I ought to follow in her footsteps and learn dressmaking from the bottom. And the first day was just sewing on buttons. And I was so miserable because we weren't allowed to talk, let alone, you know, burst into a sing-song. And when I got home, I said to Dad, I said, I don't like it. So he said, well, how much are you getting, dear? So I said, well, I'm getting 6 and 6 for the week. He said, well, that's not much point when you can go out and sing a couple of songs one night and get 7 and 6. So I saw the wisdom of his, so I put in my notice, as it were, and I got a postal order for 1 and a penny for my day's work.
What was your mum's reaction to this? She wanted you to go to work, and your dad said, blow it, you sing.
I think, a family row? No, not at all. So I decided that I would stay at home and be a mum's help and do my concerts or whatever I could at the weekends. And of course, I had been going up to London to the music publishers for years with mum with me. So I knew all the people in the music publishing circles. And I got a chance to do an audition for Billy Cotton when I was 16.
Well, when did you first hear Bing Crosby? Because he's your next choice, isn't he?
Oh, well, yes, I remember going to the cinema when, before, I mean, sound was only just being experimented with.
1928 it came in, didn't it?
And I saw a little short of him singing. And I remember he was climbing up a ladder or something outside a bedroom window. There was a little elopement scene of some sort. So, of course, I never forgot that. And, of course, never really realising that so many years later I'd have the privilege and honour of having him on one of my television programmes and singing a duet with him.
Why must I live in dreams of the days I used to know? Why can't I find real peace of mind and go back to the long ago? Where the blue of the night meets the gold of the day. Someone waits for me, and the gold of her hair crowns the blue of her eyes like a halo tenderly. If only I could see her, oh, how happy I would be.
where the blue of the night meets the gold of the day. Someone waits for me. If only I could see her, oh, how happy I would be. Where the blue of the night meets the gold of the day. Someone waits for me.
Who else but the old groaner? Mm. Bing Crosby singing Where the Blue of the Night for my guest today, Vera Lynn. Vera, these were, yes, were very hard-working years, your young years.
Yes, they were. I occasionally went and had a game of tennis with a friend or something. But, you know, I was never able to go off at weekends to dances. I remember one occasion only when I went to the East Ham Town Hall for a dance and had my first long dress made, which Mum made, which was red crepe de chine. I remember it so vividly.
Low back?
No.
She wouldn't let you wear the low back sort.
No, I wasn't into low backs, no.
Because I always think of the dresses of that period, yeah, as having those wicked swooping backs, yeah, which were so beautiful.
I think it had a cowl thing at the back, mm, if I remember. It was all on the cross, yeah, you know. But no, I didn't have a lot of time for the sort of teenage sports and things that most youngsters went in for, because I was...
You were a working girl.
I was, yes.
Do you regret that when you look back?
Well, yes and no. You know, I think probably I wasn't destined. I think one has a life planned out for them. And my practical experience that I gained in those years, you can't buy. You know, you can go to all the colleges and the dance classes and singing things, you know, but you know, to have practical experience. People used to sometimes say to me, well, when you were abroad, you know, entertaining the boys, wasn't it difficult, the kind of conditions you had to sing under, you know? I said, well, no, not in the least, because as a youngster, I was used to singing in noisy clubs with a lot of smoke, and a pianist probably, you know, I mean, if we were short of cash, I would only have the right hand transposed down. We couldn't afford the extra shilling for the bottom hand to be written in, you know. Yes. So if we got a good piano player, he would put in his own left hand. But if not, you know, you just about get your right hand. But you got used to singing, as a child, in all sorts of conditions. So, of course, that came in very handy in latter years when you were singing in all sorts of camps and
yes, out. Indeed, it would have been. Yeah. But of course, long before then, you had become one of those special people, one of the queens of the wireless, the wireless that so many of us grew up with.
Yeah.
Where did you first appear on radio?
1935, mm-hmm, and that's another little mark that I was just looking at. It was actually in August 27th, 1935. I've got the date here. And I made my very first broadcast with Joe Loss.
Ah, the great, lovely, wonderful,
yes,
Joe Loss.
Lovely, yes. Joe. And so he gave me my first opportunity. And I sang Red Sails in the Sunset.
Mm. Well, there's no question that you've brought back an enormous number of memories for a great many people. In fact, memory is what you're made of here, aren't you? You're
yes,
part of the memory,
yeah,
of generation, two generations at least. You're certainly part of mine. Thank you, though, for telling me about yourself when young.
Pleasure.
And we'll see you on your way, Vera, with your old friend Joe Loss playing In the Mood for You.
Thank you. Thank you.
the Mood with Joe Loss and his orchestra. This week, Claire Rayner, who devised Myself When Young, was talking to Dame Vera Lynn. The programme was produced by Bridget Apps. Radio 2. The time now is 7 o'clock. With the news, Nick Page.
A mass grave containing thousands of skeletons has been discovered in East Germany. It's believed they're the remains of Germans who were killed in the Stalinist internment camps after the end of the Second World War. Matt Fry in Bonn reports.
According to a report in the East German Berliner Zeitung, the mass grave was discovered 2 days ago in a forest in the Neubrandenburg region north of Berlin. A local forester discovered thousands of skeletons near Fünf Eichen, one of 9 special camps set up by the Soviet NKVD secret police in 1945. More than 65,000 Germans, most of them Nazis or officers of Hitler's Wehrmacht, were rounded up by the Stalinist NKVD at the end of the war and died in such camps, which were set up in the Soviet zone of occupation. But according to an East German historian, Dieter Krüger, many German civilians were also put into camps at random to replace any Nazis who had escaped.
There's still considerable tension on the streets of the Lithuanian capital, Vilnius, but there's been no further intensive military activity. However, a small convoy of Soviet lorries has passed through the city centre. The Lithuanian parliament met during the day to appoint a number of new ministers. Many are communists, but the foreign minister is said to be a radical deputy from the fledgling Christian Democrat Party. The Labour Party has moved into its strongest position yet in the opinion polls, following its spectacular victory in the Mid-Staffordshire by-election. A survey by Morrie for tomorrow's Sunday Times newspaper puts Labour 23 points ahead of the Conservatives. New research published in the United States shows that couples who live together before getting married are more likely to get divorced. Sociologists at an Ohio university found divorce rates among couples who'd cohabited were 66% higher than among those who stayed apart before marriage. And the weather, gales or severe winds over northern districts will slowly ease overnight, and snow showers will die out. Further south, showers will become infrequent later tonight. Tomorrow, most parts should be dry with some sunshine. That's the news, and if I get my breath back, there'll be more at 10 o'clock. Entertainment.
Radio 2. In half an hour, our Saturday gala night is a tribute to Stephen Sondheim, who was 60 last Thursday. First, though, why does Ken Bruce give 3 contestants all the wrong answers and a Radio 2 umbrella? Let's find out in tonight's ABC quiz. Yeah.
Well, thank you very kindly, and welcome along to another edition of the incredible ABC Quiz. It's incredible it's lasted this long in the series. We are here with 3 marvellous contestants who are going to have a go at our quiz. Each question we offer them has 3 possible answers, A, B, or C. Only one of them is correct, and it's up to the 3 contestants to choose which. Each correct answer earns 5 points, and they can win at the end of the quiz for first prize, £40 worth of gift vouchers, for second prize, £20 worth of gift vouchers, and for third prize, £15 worth. And the winner has a chance to win the jackpot prize, which is a stereo radio cassette recorder. Slack jaws all round. Not to mention everybody receiving a Radio 2 umbrella. Oh, yes, right. Well, here are the 3 contestants who are going to compete tonight. Ian Templeman, Doug Woods and Colin Davis. Measure of partisan support in tonight, I think. Round one this week is all about music. Do you remember how at one time the British cinema had this curious fixation with distraught pianists? Well, let's see how well you remember the specially composed concertos that accompanied their anguish. Can you pick out the Cornish Rhapsody from 2 others? Listen to this first piece. Yes, I know you've heard it, but was it the Cornish Rhapsody? Or perhaps this is Film Concerto B. Just see them rolling their eyes and looking soulful, can't you? Was that the Cornish Rhapsody, though? If you're not too sure, then listen to Film Concerto C. Exactly the same to me, I must say. One of those three, though, was the Cornish Rhapsody from the film Love Story, not the 70s film of that title, but the earlier one starring Margaret Lockwood and Stuart Granger. Which, though, was the Cornish Rhapsody? A, B, or C? It's Ian to go first.
Well, I know more about Cornish ice cream than Cornish Rhapsodies, but I'll try B.
Why not? Doug, what do you think?
Well, my reliable decision maker says C.
Okay. Colin?
I think I'll go along with C as well, for no particular reason, though.
That's as good a reason as any, I would say. And the correct answer, by the reliable decision-maker, is correct. C. So, Doug and Colin get 5 points each. Does anybody care to offer a view on what the first one was, what A might have been, Colin?
I think it was the Warschau Concerto.
He's correct.
And from the film Dangerous Moonlight, starring Anton Walbrook. And the second one, Dream of... Oh, no, I've just told you, haven't I? The Dream of Alwyn, yes. Yeah. Colin, you obviously knew what you were doing there. Are you a music fan?
Sort of.
Well, that was
I've
sort
got
of
an advantage over these two. I'm about 40 years older than them.
Not from where I'm sitting. It doesn't look like that. Where do you come from, Colin?
A little village called Tatsfield, which is up on the Downs, near Westerham in Kent.
Sounds nice. Have you been there for a long time?
20-odd years.
And what do you do in your spare time? What do you get up to?
Armchair sports fan. Mm-hmm. Swim a bit, play a bit of tennis, eat too much. Sort of dabble in local politics, but very ineffectively.
Well, it's better than dabbling ineffectively at national level, which most of the people involved in it just now.
I don't get paid for it.
We'll move on to our next question. One of the truly greats of jazz was Charlie Parker, known as Bird, master of the alto saxophone. Just listen to this. Not bad, eh? And soaring away there with Charlie Parker in a thing called Blue and Boogie was Dizzy Gillespie on trumpet. Great stuff to listen to, but do you know exactly what you were listening to? Charlie Parker invented a radical new style of jazz in the 1940s. Do you know what it became known as? Was it A, bebop, B, progressive, or C, mainstream? Colin.
This is definitely before my time, Ken, of course.
I'll go set a minute ago.
I'll try B, sir, but I don't know why.
Right. Ian?
Yes, B sounds good to me, too.
Okay, and Doug?
Well, I'll make it the three with a B.
All three going for B, and you know what? All three are absolutely wrong. Completely and utterly. Progressive jazz, which was the B answer, was the type associated with Dave Brubeck. A little bit later than that, the correct answer was A, bebop. So nobody gets a point there. Doug, you're obviously a great fan of jazz music, for the sound of things.
Yeah.
Tell me where you're from, first of all.
Southampton.
Right, and what do you get up to when you're down there? What do you do for a living, first of all?
Well, I've worked for one of the major clearers, assistant manager.
When you're not working, what do you do?
Well, I play hockey most of my spare time, so I can actually get away from the house.
You know, hockey's become a terribly popular sport. It just, it seems, in recent years, since I think probably the Olympics in Seoul. Yeah. Have you found that?
Yes, we've started to pick up a lot of kids from junior school, mm-hmm. whereas before, locally, we wouldn't see them till about 16, 17.
How long have you been playing for yourself?
18 years now.
Oh, really? Hardly look old enough, Doc.
You lied glibly.
I'm not being offensive, but it's obviously a long playing season for... I mean, you can play for quite a few years. You're not spent or burnt out by the age of 25, are you?
No, not in the standard I play in, certainly not.
You've probably gone until you're 80, really, can't you? Okay, let's see if you can go on to our next one, our next question. Have a listen to this and perhaps even lift your feet. Slow, slow, quick, quick, slow. Yes, a test of how much you know about ballroom dancing. Latin American rhythms in particular. We'll hear three from Victor Sylvester and his orchestra. All we want you to do is identify the Paso Doble from two other Latin American dances. Simple enough, isn't it? Do you want to see their faces? Is this the Paso Doble, Latin American dance tune A?